thank everybody for coming out on such a stormy night to the Westchester County Tea Party debate that's being sponsored and hosted for the two candidates running in the Senate District 40. But before we get started, we'd like to do what we do at all our meetings, and to do the Pledge of Allegiance, and I'd like to ask this young lady up here to lead us.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. First, I'd like to thank the Volunteer Ambulance Corps of North Salem for renting this room to us. And I'm going to put in a quick word for them. They're more than just an ambulance corps. They're more than just an ambulance that takes you to the hospital or provides temporary medical care. What we're sitting in here now is a certified Red Cross shelter. If everybody remembers the storms we had back in 2012 and 2011, this was the center point. People came here to get their dry ice. They got their showers in the morning. Since we didn't have electricity, we were fed here. People who lost their electricity in the area would actually bring their food down. You wouldn't believe how good the people around here eat. Shrimp, lobster, filet mignons. I tell you, each storm that I was down here, I gained 10 pounds that week. So what I'd like, they're all going to hold a fundraiser in about 3 or 4 weeks at the Farm and Fish. And there's a page over there I'd like you all to take where we could give them a donation and thank them for renting us the room. Thank them for what they've done for us during the storms in the past. And needless to say, since we live where trees lay over power lines, the storms for the future. The other thing I'd like to do is thank you from the Westchester County Tea Party. We've been around since the beginning of the movement in 2009. It all started at a kitchen table in someone's house and grew from there. We've had rallies. We've been getting involved in the candidates and getting involved in the elections. We're not happy with the national debt, a few of the things that's been going on in government, but we all realize that we have to focus on a 15-hour window, and that's the first Tuesday of every November. That is how change is made in this country, and that's what we focus on. In the past, we've gotten involved in the Romney campaign, and we knew in New York State we couldn't possibly win. So what we did on weekends is we went out to Pennsylvania, which was a toss-up state. American Prosperity gave us a list of soft Republicans, soft Dems, and we went and knocked on doors. Last year, we got involved in one of the county legislators' campaigns called Lady Miriam Flisser down in down county. And our group, in conjunction with their campaign, knocked on 6,000 doors and met the people and asked them to come out and vote. This is how change is made. A recent thing we did, we got involved everybody's heard of the Stop Common Core ballot line. They got 65,000 signatures. Our group put out over 600 of those signatures. Another group has recently approached us called Concerned Veterans for America. What they do is they contact veterans within the state and try to get them out to vote. They found that there's about 1 million veterans in New York State, and only about 50% of them go to the polls. They've got the list of veterans laid out by congressional district, and they call people in congressional districts where there's a chance to win a seat and encourage them to vote and make sure they're conservatives. So our group has gotten involved with them. They bring down the telephones to us. We all meet at our meeting place in White Plains, which is a sports page restaurant. And we got on the phone and we called up everybody on the list that night. And we're going to continue to do this every month. And the idea is this isn't just a one election season. They're looking at 2016 and beyond. They want to win the White House. These are some of the things that the Westchester County Tea Party does. We're just a group of people who go down, we have meetings, but we try to get involved in things that can make a difference. Our event tonight is going to be moderated by Steve Mayo. Steve Mayo is a graduate of the Maxwell School of Citizenship and Public Affairs at Syracuse University back in, I don't want to tell you the year. He earned his Juris Doctorate degree at DePaul University College of Law. He's been employed in careers of journalism, law, product innovation, sales and marketing. And you may know him as the host of the Steve Mayo Show on WVOX Radio. It's an AM station, but it's live streamed on the internet, so we all watch it up here. So let me turn this over to Steve Mayo, who'll begin our event tonight.
Thank you, Howard, and thank you, Westchester County Tea Party, for asking me to moderate this very important evening. The candidates have asked about the expenditure of time. I think it's a fair question, and also in light of the weather. The estimate from Howard is, after it is begun in earnest, will go for about an hour, respecting your commitments and your needs, and of course the safety of ourselves and our crowd. These rules were determined before the meeting tonight, and we decided to determine by flip of coin who would open first, and that flip was won by Dr. Murphy, and meaning that the first to close would be Rob Castelli. Two candidates tonight are running for the Republican nomination for the 40th Senatorial District nomination of the Republican Party. This seat is presently held by Greg Ball, and he holds the seat now, and he is not running for re-election. So a primary has been made necessary. The primary election is on September 9th, 2014, to be followed by the November election. So please, by all means, in the primary and the election, remember to vote. The basic format of our evening of debate tonight will be an opening statement by each candidate for 5 minutes, and then a response by the non-opening candidate for 1 minute. And we're going to have a further 1 minute 5 minute opening statement by each candidate, beginning with Dr. Murphy, followed by Rob Castelli. And the opening statement will be provided by Dr. Murphy. The first closed statement will be by Robert Castelli at the end of the presentation. Following the opening presentations, there will be a formal questioning session offered to the audience. And audience members will be asked to just line up quarterly like in front of the microphone, and you'll be asked to take no more than 30 seconds, please, to ask a question. Do not grandstand if possible. We realize some questions require context or background. We understand that will be reasonable, but please try not to make it an oration or a campaign statement for one party or another, or just for the Republican Party. Write an email to President Obama. Tonight we're trying to determine a very important nomination process. The question will be asked generally, and each candidate will be given a chance to answer for 1 minute to the audience question, followed by the other candidate answering to the very same question. We're hoping that responses will end there, but the organizers have asked that there be a rebuttal allowed, a brief 30-second rebuttal session allowed if one answer results in the other candidate being put on the spot or somehow mentioned by name or somehow justifying a direct response from the other candidate. That may be a little hard to enforce, and I ask your indulgence if I have to make such decisions. 10 seconds before the answer, answering periods, a sign will be held up by the gentleman in the middle, showing you that the time is about to end. And of course, the timing will be controlled by the orange sitting on the floor in front of the same gentleman, that famous kitchen stalwart, a timing orange. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Dr. Murphy to open the proceedings.
Can everybody hear me back there?
Yes.
So, do you need a microphone?
Yes.
Use the mic. Well, first off, I'd just like to thank everybody for coming here tonight at the Tea Party. Good evening, and thank you so much for inviting me here tonight. It's an honor to be part of this process. This is the kind of night that makes you proud to be an American, to be here. Right here in North Salem. This is what democracy is all about. The very way of life that make men like my father and Bob Castelli, who defended America with their buddies halfway around the world. So it's not a stretch to say, thanks for tonight, Bob. Appreciate it. thanks to my dad for Korean War. Thank you. I'm going to be brief by saying it's humbling to be even considered for the state senate. I'm grateful for the opportunity to let you know where I stand. So you can see where Bob and I may differ on some of these issues, and indeed where we very well might agree on a bunch of them. I believe my record speaks for itself. My conservative credentials are as rock solid as they can be. As a Yorktown town councilman, I passed the first two consecutive tax cuts in over a generation for the town of Yorktown. I've created hundreds of jobs through ushering in close to $250 million worth of economic development to the town of Yorktown. Along the way, which I am very proud of, I demanded and we passed unprecedented ethics legislation in the town of Yorktown, which we did not have. Since I've been in office, I'm proud to say that Yorktown is a more affordable place to live, where jobs can be had and elected officials are held to the highest standards. So Bob, let's get it on, and thank you everyone for coming here tonight.
I'm going to stand up so I can see you all in the back of the room now. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, Steve and Terrence. Thank you for coming here tonight. Terrence and I have discussed many things as it relates to this race in the past, and we will continue to do so in the same friendly manner that we always have. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Bob Castelli. I'm a two-term New York State Assemblyman. For a short period of time, I had the honor of being the Assemblyman for here in North Salem when the issue was gerrymandered once again, as we see frequently from time to time in our State Assembly and Senate. I spent the entirety of my adult life in the service of my country and my community. I started out as a young soldier at 17 years old. I served in Vietnam as an infantry sergeant during the Tet Offensive. When I came back, I spent the next 21 years in law enforcement in the New York State Police. I served here in the area as a resident trooper in Lewisboro, as a trooper down in Hawthorne, in Somers, and in all around the state of New York. It was my honor to serve in the uniform both of my nation and of the New York State Police. From there, I went on to school, completed two undergraduate degrees in criminal justice, and finally, at the end of my state police career, completing a graduate degree from the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University in Criminal Justice Policy and Management, where I was awarded a Pickett Fellowship from the National Institute of Justice in light of the 20-year contribution I had made to law enforcement. Beyond that, I spent 4 years as a member of the Lewisboro Town Board. I wanted to stay in public service. I wanted to give back to my community. I came to Lewisboro as a young trooper, and I decided to stay there. This is the area in which I live. This is the area that I love. And it is a place that both Terrence and I agree is a place that's wonderful, and both of us have decided to try and serve. From there, I was fortunate enough to get elected to the New York State Assembly. I was elected in what was the second most Democratic district in the county of Westchester. No Republican had held that seat for over 18 years. I was fortunate to capture that seat, even though the proportion between Republicans and Democrats was 20% more Democrats than Republicans. I was, as a result of that, the state assemblyman for people like Bill Clinton, Hillary Clinton, our governor, and a multitude of people, some of whom you've seen on some mailers that have come out walking with me in what was the Memorial Day parade where we honored our fallen soldiers. And of course, it is my honor to walk with anybody if they are honoring our fallen soldiers. While in the New York State Assembly, I had a distinguished record. I passed 6 pieces of my own legislation, over 35 pieces of co-sponsored legislation. In fact, it was the best record of any Republican assemblyman for that period of time. I served as a ranking member on Veterans Affairs in the New York State Assembly, a ranking member on the Committee on the Aging, as well as on the committees for environmental conservation, the election law, and a number of other important committees, including environmental conservation. While there, I sponsored the toughest ethics bill in the state of New York. I also sponsored ethics legislation to disclose the sources of Al-Qaeda income to legislators. Additionally, I sponsored legislation for term limits for legislators, which I might add, in the election law committee, everyone voted down but me, and I might add, Republicans and Democrats, shame on all of us. I was the only vote to put it out to the floor for a vote. it still never has seen the light of day. But at the end of the day, you have to talk the talk and walk the walk. And I did so in an environment where I would say you were swimming with the sharks. Well, I've swum with the sharks, and I've survived. It's my honor to do this job. My purpose in coming here tonight to meet all of you is not to tell you why Terrence, who I know we have been friendly for many years, shouldn't be your state senator. My purpose in coming here is to tell you why I think I should be. So that is the tone that I'd like to set for the evening. Terrence and I have always been respectful to each other and friendly, and we will be at the end of this, and at the end of this race, regardless of the outcome. So I wish him well, and I give this back to our moderator. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Murphy and Assemblyman Castelli. To begin the questioning period from the audience, I'll invite questions from anybody in the audience. I've been asked by Howard Hellwinkle, our sponsor, that, again, we refrain from campaign declarations by questioners, lay the groundwork for the question, and then ask a question. And we are asked that both gentlemen answer the question in turn. And for the first answer, I will ask, for the first question, I ask it for now. And I will ask the answer to go to someone who is up. Anybody want to ask any questions? Please step to the microphone, make a an important remark.
My name is Regina Riley. I'm from the town of Portland. Can you hear me now? I usually can talk loud if I have to. Okay. I'm from the town of Portland, and my question is this. Since you have, if you were to win the primary, you would only have a Republican, the Republican line, and Mr. Murphy has both the independent and the conservative line. That would mean you would have a line, he'd have two lines, and Wagner would have the women's equality line, which is to get non-doctors to be able to do abortions for all 9 months. That's the reason that line is there. He'd have that line, he'd have the Republican line, I mean the Democratic line, and you have the socialist family. So the question is, why would you want to allow Wagner to get the to get the seat, since we're very close to losing the majority? In fact, we've already lost the majority in the Senate.
Thank you for your question. Well, first of all, I wouldn't allow Mr. Wagner to get the seat. I intend to win the race, just like I intended to win the primary. You know, this is a seat that I've looked at for a number of years. This is not something I came to in the last minute. And many people, including Senator Greg Hall, who were looking to replace, knew that I was interested in a seat should he ever decide to vacate. So my answer to you is very simply this. If I win the Republican primary, then I would expect that Terrence would probably drop out of the race. If he chooses not to, we will have a three-way candidacy. That's his prerogative, and certainly his right to do so. On the other hand, I took one single line, because at the end of the day, this is about Republicans doing what Republicans do, which is engaging in a legitimate forum so we can have dialogues to have our own conservative agenda put forth. So the answer to your question is, I believe by winning the Republican line, I can win the election. If I didn't think so, I wouldn't be in this election now. Thank you for your question.
Dr. Murphy.
Well, thank you very much for the question, Regina. Yes, I am the Republican nominee. I'm sitting with the Independents Party nominee and the Conservative nominee, and I also did a write-in for the Common Core, Stop Common Core. So, God willing, we will win that Common Core line. We needed 3,000 signatures. We got roughly about 5,200 signatures, so we look pretty good on that. So, going into November's election, God willing, you know, I win this next, not next week, September the 9th, I would have four lines to Mr. Wagner's three, and would give us a great opportunity to keep this seat, which is incredibly crucial to the state Senate of New York. This seat can take the balance of whether we stay in the majority or we go to the minority. So God willing, it works in my favor. I look forward to representing it, but yes, I will have the Republican line. God willing, I would be September 9th and the Republican, Independent, and Conservative County Board.
Thank you, Duncan. The next question will be addressed to Dr. Campbell.
Captain Murphy, considering the number of people who were killed by...
name and tell.
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Fred Higgin. I live in Somers, New York. And my question to you is, considering the number of people who have been killed by gun violence in the United States, do you oppose or support having violent criminals report to a national gun registry?
Well, violent criminals should not be having any type of handgun, I believe. At the end of the day, you know, this is a matter of, want to go into the SAFE Act? You want to just answer that question with regards to violent criminals. Violent criminals have no, they belong in jail.
And suppose they have these weapons, shouldn't they be shot? Shouldn't they be made to...
be registered? Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's my question.
Yeah. Yeah. No doubt about it. Okay. Yeah. I mean, you're a convicted felon. I don't think you should be walking around with a with a gun ready to go out and commit another felony crime.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Simple.
Question here. No. I understood your question quite well. 21 years in the state police. 15 years as a criminal justice professor, and having five of my friends killed in the line of duty, I'm not a fan of violent felons. As you probably know, if you are convicted of a felony in the state of New York, you cannot possess a firearm, and that is as it should be. Violent felons should be locked up, period, the end. Terrence and I are in agreement on that one, and under the circumstances, but that should not infringe upon other people's Second Amendment rights to keep and bear arms, because they are mutually exclusive. So thank you for your question, sir.
Thank you, Assemblyman Castelli. Next question, gentlemen in the green, please address it to the Assemblyman again. And thank you for the lady in the audience. Please state your name.
Richard Aslander, town of Lewisboro. I must also disclose Mr. Castelli and Senator and Dr. Murphy's father and I are brothers. I'm a disabled veteran. Question for you.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you. Thank your father and Mr. Castelli for theirs. My question is on immigration. Basically, we're a country of immigrants. How do you stand on immigration? Should it be open or should it be closed?
First of all, thank you for your service. I'm also a disabled veteran, and I thank Terrence's dad for his as well. At the end of the day, those things are not political. Those are a matter of honor, so thank you and welcome home. From the standpoint of immigration, we are a nation of immigrants. We all came to this country as immigrants. And from my standpoint, it's very simple. We welcome everyone with open arms if they come in the front door. Unless and until such time as they do come in the front door, then people who are illegal immigrants need to be treated as illegal immigrants and deported. However, legal immigration is something I think that has gotten us some of the best and the brightest people in our nation and some of our finest citizens. So thank you for your question, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Murray.
Immigration. Illegal is illegal. My father-in-law came off the boat from Galway. My mother-in-law came off the boat from Offaly. They came there when they were 12 and 14 years old. They came through the right way. They have social security numbers and they busted their little hiney to make sure that they could provide for the family. We've got to wrap our hands around this issue because we're losing good jobs to our home people right here. I have no problem taking care of people. I do it for a living. My wife does it for a living. She's a nurse, I'm a doctor. We take care of people. We have to give everybody the opportunity to succeed here in America, but we have to do it the right way. We have to make sure that they come through and we know, I mean, in New York City, I think they were just gonna pass, give ID cards to anybody who was coming in and wanted to sign up and get an ID card so they can go out and get a driver's license. It's absolutely imperative that everybody comes through the right way, like Mr. Castells.
Next question, please. Dr. Murphy.
Hi, I'm Steve Horn, KORN in Lakeland. I'm also an elected school board member in the Cortland, Lakeland area. My question is economic. What are you going to advocate and fight for to make New York a more attractive place for business and employment? And 30 seconds worth of background. Jobs are being created in Texas, Tennessee, and a number of places, but not New York. Upstate New York is dying, if not already dead. And this state highly depends upon Wall Street. If that isn't healthy, there's no tax revenue. So I'd be interested in your point of view. What are you going to advocate for to make this more attractive?
Great question, Steve. New York is upside down. We have got the highest property taxes in the United States of America, and we are the least business-friendly state in the United States of America. It is a recipe for disaster. We've lost close to 400,000 people in the past 3.5 years here in New York State, including some real good doctors. At the end of the day, cut the onerous rules and regulations. Reach out to businesses and ask them, why are we advertising Startup New York in New York? That's where you have to get. $200 million has been spent on that advertising campaign. It's a political ad. You know that, and I think I know that. But at the end of the day, we have to create jobs. This is a matter of keeping roofs over the people's heads and food on the kids' family, food on the kids' tables. You know what? I did it in Yorktown. In the past 4.5 years as a councilman, I've ushered in close to $250 million worth of economic development. Costco, the revitalization of the Jefferson Valley Mall, the state-of-the-art sports complex, and the 30,000 square foot Mount Kisco Medical Group.
Thank you very much. Assemblyman Castelli, the same question.
Thank you, sir. Well, you're right. We're going to hell in a handbasket, and there's no question about that. I had the honor and privilege of serving on the Regional Economic Development Council throughout the state of New York, and that created hundreds of millions of dollars in jobs throughout all of the regions of New York State. At the end of the day, we need to incentivize our businesses to stay and grow in New York. Some of that has been done, and it's been done, you know, in kind of a halfway fashion. I think what we need to do is we need to incentivize growth. We need to incentivize individuals to come to New York, not just to stay in New York. Now, we can do that in a multiplicity of different ways. We can do that through tax incentives. We can do that for some deregulation on Wall Street, although not completely. Obviously, there needs to be some regulation of what happens on Wall Street. We've seen that in the past. But a multiplicity of different functions that can be instituted at the level of government insofar as tax incentive, job creation, and a multiple of various different relaxation of some regulations. And I think that that'll do it for us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Assemblyman. Your name and address, please, and this is to be addressed to Assemblyman Castelli.
Yes, my name is John Francis. I'm from Southeast New York. And my question is, will you state that you oppose abortion under any, without absolutely no exceptions?
You know, that's a good question. And it's an interesting question because given the fact that both Terrence and I are Roman Catholics, our feeling on the sanctity of life is the same. However, having said that, my moral compass points in the direction that I have to follow. Roe v. Wade is the law of the land, and I need to respect women's right to choose and a family's right to choose in concert with their doctor. That doesn't make me pro-abortion, but it does make me pro-woman. So I'm going to have to respect the law.
Here because I just want to make this crystal clear, and I've called and Bob and I have had numerous conversations. I'm sure some people in here have gotten mailers that have gone, that really bad mailers that have come in your mailbox. I just want it crystal clear, and Bob, you and I know we've talked about this. Terrence Murphy's camp has absolutely nothing to do with any of those mailers. I state that emphatically. I will stand up against anybody whoever is sending out mailers against Bob about you know, some of the stuff that you see. Please stop. Thank you. To answer your question.
Thank you, Terrence.
That's been a long time coming. We've had multiple conversations on it. I wouldn't want it done to me. I told you and I had an agreement we wouldn't be doing this, and I just wanted to make, well, we have all three quarters here, enough and correct.
Much appreciated.
My father's one of eight. My mother's one of three. I'm the youngest of six kids. I was an altar boy. It's a matter of a faith decision for me. It's a moral compass for me. At the end of the day, my mother's got 19 grandchildren, six great-grandchildren. Thank God, they're all healthy. At the end of the day, I'm more of a pro-life type of guy, okay? That's just my faith base, okay? Overturning Roe versus Wade still is not going to change New York State. Still wouldn't do, and it would have absolutely no effect on New York State if that ever happened. So it is what it is. I'm a pro-life type of guy. I love my kids. I have a beautiful wife. She's given me three healthy kids. God willing, maybe we can have a few more.
My name is Marilyn Miller. My name is Marilyn Miller. I'm from Southeast. I understand that you're backed by Dean Skelos and Pataki. Dean Skelos brought us the Safe Act, and Pataki brought us the Assault Weapons Ban. And you recently joined the NRA, but you have no pro to any history. How are you going to fight for our constitutional rights when you're backed by two guys that are rhinos? I don't know how else to put that.
I'm Terrence Murphy. I'm not Dean Skelos or Governor Pataki. At the end of the day, they're asking me about the Second Amendment rights.
Yep.
As an NRA member, I'll fight to protect your Second Amendment rights. I'll fight to protect and, you know, to repeal the Safe Act. But as law-abiding citizens overnight became criminals, such as people that have had heirlooms from generation to generation handed down to them, you've had our local police officers, you've had our sheriffs, you've had our state troopers. And what about the domestically abused ladies who've exercised their Second Amendment right to protect themselves from an ex-husband that might come through? They became criminals overnight. I get why they did that. I understand that. We had one of the worst tragedies in the United States of America not too far down the road. And as a father of three, it brought me to the core. But at the end of the day, you don't pass any important legislation like that at 2 o'clock in the morning. That's as good as a passing Obamacare.
Location. I'm sorry. Answer by.
Thank you for your question. Well, certainly, Terrence and I agree on that one. For those of you who may or may not know me, I have been a lifelong shooter and a competitive shooter. I competed at the world and national level 20 years ago. I'm a life member of the NRA, endorsed by the New York State Rifle and Pistol Association, and a staunch supporter of the Second Amendment. I supported the Second Amendment. I debated it on the floor of the New York State Assembly in a public forum. So I have a track record of defending our Second Amendment rights. I believe in that, and I might add that as a criminal justice professor, as a police officer who's had friends killed in the line of duty, as well as a legislator, I recognize that you cannot legislate against insanity. And sadly, the New York Safe Act, which was passed in the middle of the night, as Terrence pointed out, was passed as a rush to judgment based upon the fact that a number of people were terribly taken back by the horrific loss of those young people's lives. All of us mourned their loss. That law would not have saved a single one of their lives. So, again, we thank you for your question, sir.
Thank you so much. Okay, identify yourself on your
Richard Auslander, town of Lewisboro.
Yeah.
Question, how do you stand on affordable housing?
How do I stand on affordable housing? I voted for and helped pass some affordable housing legislation during the two terms I was in the New York State Assembly. Now, that's affordable housing that affected the entire state of New York. As far as the affordable housing settlement in the state, as it relates to Westchester County. We ended up settling in court much too quickly in a settlement that we had more legal redress on and should not have fallen over and bit the bullet and settled on. The particular settlement that we had, which our county executive and previous county executive, I might add, signed into law, gave us certain parameters as to what we should do. Unfortunately for all of us, and I include Rob Astorino in that, we all signed on the dotted line, we agreed to comply with the federal regulations. They came back to us and decided to violate the terms of that contract. So, do I think affordable housing is a good idea? Yes. Do I think the plan that we have in Westchester now being shoved down our throat is a good idea? The answer is a resounding no.
Affordable housing, Rich, correct?
Correct.
I think your town is the poster child for that. We have, we just built 26 units right across the street from BJ's. They're beautiful units for people that, some teachers that just can't quite afford to make it. They're commuting down to New York City, and the units came out absolutely beautiful. With retrospect to what the HUD development is in Westchester County, I am completely against anybody taking home rule away from us. Meaning home rule from away from our town, they're gonna go down any street, and if there's a house there, they're able to buy it, they're able to build a 2-3-story house there and have affordable housing anywhere they want. We will lose our home rule. We will lose our zoning privileges if this goes through. I am completely against it.
Thank you.
Please say your name and address for Dr. Mert.
I'm Ed Riley from Crow. I'm a citizen of Westchester. I'm back with Right to Life has been active in every political contest in this county for the last 20 years with great success in the last 7 years. We're active in this campaign. And I want to say that we can never support a person that supports or does not fight against burning children to death, decapitating children, not having inspections of abortion mills, wasting money on embryonic stem cells research to the tune of $500 million just because a local guy was involved, not fighting against corruption in the Republican Party, Libel, Fat Nikki Spano, all their friends in the Assembly and the Senate. And although I love Howard Inman, and I'd like to congratulate him for this thing tonight, this is the wrong way to approach a Republican campaign when you're fighting tooth and nail for one lousy Senate seat. When the only hope this year is to hang on to the Senate or to make a compromise with some of those Democrats. So to run a primary or support a primary is the dumbest damn thing I've ever seen.
It's probably
the problem of the Tea Party. There is a question here. The question is, why do Republicans tolerate corruption among themselves? Libel is a perfect example. That Assemblyman Stevens, and if it wasn't for Ball, who's a somewhat quixotic character, raising hell, standing on a seat when an assemblyman, not sitting on his seat when he was an assemblyman, standing on a seat, complaining, yelling, screaming about immigration, right, nothing would have been accomplished as opposed to a guy that got along and get along. The guy's the same as Latimer. What are you going to do about that? Are you going to talk about the unborn child? Are you going to ask the question, why do the state police, here we have a state policeman, here's the other question, why do the state police in this state guard the governor when he goes to see prostitutes in other state? Why does the governor of Arkansas feel that it's right to use the state police? Why does Governor Patterson feel it's right to use the state police to investigate other people?
Point made. Thank you.
Soapbox.
I think you're a pro life type of guy. I think I stated as your representative possibly up there in the Senate. I'll say it again. I come from a big family. I'm a pro life type of guy. It's a faith thing for me. I am, you know, I got three beautiful kids. And like I said, hopefully I can have a few more. You know, my mother's got 19 grandchildren, six great-grandchildren, and at the end of the day, see what happens. I'm not sure if that
was... Thank you, Doctor. Want to take a stab at someone?
Okay, Terrence answered that part, so I'll answer the other part. Nobody should tolerate corruption in government. At the end of the day, it's your government, it's not our government. I've spent my life fighting corruption. I spent 10 years in the Organized Crime Task Force. I arrested police.
What did you do when you were in the Assembly fighting corruption in the Republican Party? Nothing.
Well, you may want to let me answer that question, sir.
Answer it.
Okay, as I said when I first made my opening statement, I put in the toughest ethics bill in the state of New York's history.
Didn't work, did it?
Well, that was Sheldon Silver's doing. You should talk to him. I also helped pass the Public Integrity Act of 2011. That did work, sir. And put in term limits for legislators. So at the end of the day, I try to fight the fight. Whether it was successful or not is not the question. The question is, do you talk the talk and walk the walk? And I did. So I think in this particular area, I understand your anger. I respect that. You're a citizen. You have a right to express that opinion. We will both, either one of us who gets up there, do our best to do the right thing. I think I can speak for both of us on that. Thank you.
Question will go to someone else.
Richard Lyman, I'm supervisor of the town of Pound Ridge. Unfunded mandates. They're devastating to small communities statewide. Things like prevailing wage, things like how about the scaffold law? These are all things that were passed in Albany that cause small towns untold millions in order to try and do business. I think the latest one, Warren, you're over there, is Universal Pre-K, better known, I think, really as Universal Daycare. But how much is that going to cost the town of North Salem School District?
If they implement it, it's a couple million bucks.
There you have it. What are you going to do about it if you're elected? Are you going to fight for the small communities that you represent, or are you going to let Albany just trample us?
Thank you. Well, thank you for your question, Supervisor Lyman. I think you already know me, and you know what I did in these communities. So, I think I'd say I let my record speak for itself. Most of these people don't know what my record is. So, at the end of the day, I put in bills to remove unfunded mandates. You know, we wanted to make sure, a handful of us up there, that if there were unfunded mandates, we would either find a way to fund them for you, or we would rescind them. So, did that work? No, it didn't work. But you know what? Frequently, change doesn't come quickly, but it comes by people who are willing to fight the fight and who have the backbone. Originally, we passed the 2% tax cap, which I supported and voted for, by the way. One of the things I asked the governor, because as you know, he was one of my constituents, and I had a decent working relationship with the guy, I said, well, you know, you promised us mandate relief. And he said to me, Bob, I gave everything we could in this particular legislative session. I said, well, we need to readdress it again. When we came back again, he put together a mandate control commission to try and deal with this. As you know, the best way to address something and ignore it is to do it with a panel or a commission. The answer is, we take another bite of that apple, we keep fighting that fight.
Thank you.
Better not have any more kids, Universal Daycare, huh? All the kids. Unfunded mandates, the scaffolding law, I don't know if you're familiar with it.
Yeah.
It's virtually impossible to get insurance from some of these builders. And the insurance that you try and get, it's astronomical. And there goes the price of your job. So it's really incredible how they completely throw the onerous onto the owner or the project manager, when you could possibly have some of the workers that are, I don't want to say under the influence, but aren't maybe sick or not feeling well and fall off the scaffold, and they are 100% protected. To get back to you in front of a minute, what about a circuit breaker? You want to see a lot of unfunded mandates stop coming down our way? Put a circuit breaker on it. Find out an X amount of dollars, what it would be. $10,000, $20,000, $25,000. You're not anything up to that, the state pays. Now, inevitably, we would all have to pay, but at least it would drive it down the road for a few years.
If you don't mind, just a point of clarification. Could you explain what a circuit breaker means? And if you can respond to that explanation, please be my guest, because I'm not too familiar.
Well, the circuit breaker means that if you're one of the politicians in Albany and you find this unfunded mandate and you turn around and you say, okay, the unfunded mandate is going to cost $50,000 and the circuit breaker is at $25,000, the state pays up to $25,000 of it. And then they're going to have to try and send it down to us.
That's fine. Perfect. Next questioner, please address your question and give us your name and address.
My name is Chuck Banks. I was born in this district. I've been an elected official in this district for over 20 years. I was a town supervisor and a town judge, but I'm not here to talk about municipal issues. I'm back to Second Amendment. Both of you talk a very good game about your dedication to the Second Amendment and to our Second Amendment freedoms. What I need to know is something a little more in depth. What in your life experience, and obviously I'm addressing this to both, is going to make me comfortable as a 53-year life member of the NRA that you're the person to send to Albany to protect our Second Amendment rights?
Well, like I said before, you have a law that was instilled overnight at 2 o'clock in the morning that made law-abiding citizens, some of our police officers, criminals overnight. My brother-in-law is an NYPD cop in New York City. His task was gun control. He's told me numerous stories about how these criminals will get the guns. No matter what, they will find it. He sits on top of roofs and he watches some of the deals go down. What I would try and do is to fix some of this, is maybe we should start looking at our disastrous mental health department and try and get some of these people some help. And maybe we won't have some of these tragedies that have affected America and our local neighbor. One of the most devastating, it's just a complete tragedy what happened over in Newtown. But as far as your Second Amendment rights, it's your constitutional right.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you. You know, just to segue back to what Terrence has just finished saying, there is no law in the books, and no one could write a law that could stop the horrific thing that took place there. And any one of us would be the first one to sign on to that law if we knew we could. There's no law that could save the five of my friends who were killed in the line of duty crimes in the state police. But I think your question is basically a background question insofar as, you know, what our bona fides is with the Second Amendment. I'm an NRA rifle, pistol, and shotgun instructor. I was a competitive shooter at the world and national level. My father was an NRA rifle, pistol, and shotgun instructor. I started shooting at the age of five, believe it or not. As a result of having spent a lifetime both instructing the safe use of firearms, using them as a police officer, as a training instructor, as a sports shooter, and also as somebody who has hunted in the state of New York, I got the bona fides to have done this. As somebody who's done it in all of the areas where shooting takes place, I've also defended the Second Amendment on the floor of the New York State Assembly. So I hope that answers your question.
Thank you. Next question, put your ID again, please, if you don't mind, and be addressed to the Assemblyman.
My name is Marilyn Miller, and I'm from Southeast. You were a town councilman, so you would know the ethics involved in voting yourself a raise. Have you ever, voted yourself a raise or
done anything that the taxpayers weren't aware of?
No, ma'am. Everything I've done, you know, in the public trust and in the public eye. You know, I believe in transparency in government is a short answer. So, hope that answers your question.
With respect, I'm just pointing to the first part of the question. I'm not trying to put you on the spot. Have you ever voted for yourself a benefit, a pension increase, or a salary increase?
No, the answer is no.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Clarify it.
What Marilyn's talking about was 2 weeks ago at our town board meeting. Nice question, Marilyn. I tell you that your answer to your question was, I'm the only one who didn't vote myself a raise. I voted that we, as elected officials and our department heads that have been after us for almost 4 years, some of them that did not get raises, they were after us. So what we did is said, let's follow the CSEA. So if you're going to negotiate against the CSEA, you're going to negotiate against yourself. I voted on that. Then there was a second vote. The second vote was to vote to instill these raises immediately. And I voted no. Councilman Patel voted yes. Council Supervisor Grace voted yes. And Councilman Bianco voted yes. So I did not vote myself a raise 2 weeks ago.
Regina Riley from the unincorporated area of Krugers in the town of Cortland. I just have to give a little background here. There's a gentleman by the name of Dr. Gosnell who was put away for life imprisonment in our neighbor, Pennsylvania, because he murdered two children after they were born, and they were living and perfectly healthy. In fact, he should have been put in life imprisonment for about 15 or more than that children that he actually did. I'm saying this because there is a bill that's up there that Cuomo is pushing, and it's known as the Women's Equality Act. And if it passes, number one, there will never be a Republican majority anywhere for the next 50 years, all right? And number two, he's got a line called the Women's Equality Line, which has nothing more to do than to pass this Women's Equality Act, which includes...
Please make a question
out. I'm trying to. I want to know if they're going to vote for it, either of them. What this includes is non-doctors doing an abortion for all 9 months. That's what it will allow. It will also allow... it will decriminalize abortion so that forced and coerced abortions will not be held on the criminal code. Not held on the criminal code. It means it would not allow parents to have a right to know or to give permission to their underage children. And it would allow sexual predators to get away with murder. Thank you.
The question was, would you vote for this Women's Equality Act?
Women's Equality
Act. No.
Women's Equality Act. Regina, I know what you're talking about. As a matter of fact, at Yorktown, as a Yorktown town councilman, I actually passed a resolution because the bill that you're talking about throws the baby out with the bathwater. And the 9.5 month, because gestation, which people don't realize, is actually 10 months. Time to figure it out. It's always 9 months, people think. But 9.5 month non-medical abortions, to me, that's murder. At the end of the day, when you jeopardize not only the baby, but also the mother, and some of these clinics that have been here in New York haven't even been inspected in years, it's an atrocity. That's all I can tell you. The Women's Equality Act on the Senate side, it's not a thumbs down, because what happens is it allows, I would love my daughter to make the same amount of money as any CEO in this country. And this is my philosophy, is you give everybody the opportunity to succeed here. And at the end of the day, when you want to start segregating people off, major malfunction.
Okay, short answer to your question, ma'am, is no. There is, as you know, the point 10 in that bill is late-term abortions, which I obviously am adamantly opposed to. You're right, I do think that's murder. I don't believe that non-doctors should perform abortion. Again, on a personal level, I don't believe in abortion, but that's me, myself.
You can't do it that way.
You actually can do that because we have a separation of church and state in the Constitution of the United States. And I can only make decisions from my moral compass. I can't make them for yours.
I've said no now three times,
but I'll say it one more time. The answer is no.
I think it's very important. Okay. Thank you, Doctor. Next question, please. Your name and address, please, to be directed to Assemblyman, please, Doctor.
Hi, Kathy Cepeda, Phillipstown, New York. Good evening, everyone. So today is a milestone day for those who are in the fight against the Common Core. Bobby Jindal has filed a lawsuit against the federal government. The evidence is overwhelming that Common Core is not about education. It is about control, and it is about making money. Bill Gates has said it's a 10-year experiment. Should we allow Common Core to continue in our school districts?
No. It should be repealed. Period. The end. You know, there have been a number of people who tried to tweak this and try to make it right and fix it and what have you. At the end of the day, you can't fix something that starts out as broken. I think it needs to be repealed. I think we need to start from scratch. The concept of holding our teachers and our students to excellent standards is great. I, as a teacher, understand that. But you and I think have had this conversation before. This particular program stinks, and it should be repealed. And I would support the repeal of it if I go up there. Thank you, ma'am.
Kathy, thank you so much for the question. Actually, I got a line to stop Common Core. We needed 3,000 petitions, and I think we got 5,200. And I've been to every forum in this 40th Senate district. Not only have I talked to superintendents of schools, I've talked to the teachers. And most importantly, I've talked to the kids. I live, breathe, and eat it every single night at my kitchen table with my three kids. It's a disaster. It's 2 + 2 doesn't equal 4 anymore, according to them. It's absolutely something that I think, no point intended here, folks, they shot and now they're eating. This is, they took $700 million, and New York is one of only two states that fast-tracked the implementation of it. Some of my friends are teachers. They don't know how to teach it. And now they're being evaluated on it. They're scared to death for their jobs. It's a disaster.
Please identify your name and your location for Dr. Murphy.
My name is Mike Peters, Peekskill. We all seem to be in agreement here that the SAFE Act has to go. But also, would you both be agreeable to revisiting the laws in New York, of course, the Sullivan Act, the Sullivan law that we have, that's pretty harsh, but also to allow collectors in New York State, to allow NFA weapons be allowed in New York State for collectors, the way the majority of the most of the country allows NFA weapons, firearms. Once they're registered and you go through the proper procedure to have them, you're allowed to have these firearms. They're on collectors' curio lists for the ATF. But in New York State, they're prohibited. Would you allow NFA weapons?
Well, that was my point that I said earlier, that you've had generation after generation, great-grandfathers handing it down to their kids and their kids, and these kids have got collections of guns that, you know, are priceless, to be quite honest with you. To answer your question, most certainly not. I mean, you become a criminal overnight with the bill. That's why my point was, anything that's past 2 o'clock in the morning, something as important as that, they should have weighed in on these issues. We had, when they passed the bill, police officers were criminals going onto school grounds. So, you know, at the point, at this point, you know, repeal it, repeal that, repeal the Safe Act, and if you're going to do something like that, weigh in. Have people get a consensus from the NRA, from the different type of groups, and let them weigh in on this. But to answer your question, to become an overnight criminal because you actually took your grandfather's collections of guns, probably.
Appreciate it. Assemblyman?
Thank you. Well, first of all, revisiting all of these laws certainly is germane. Keep in mind that the Sullivan Law is something that was passed by the City Council of the City of New York, and they have autonomy to promulgate their own rules and regulations. So, while I don't agree with the Sullivan Law, I would say to you the state legislature could not, because the City of New York has autonomy, revisit that law and change that for them. As far as the possession of NFA weapons, I don't have a problem with that whatsoever. So the short answer is, you know, protect your Second Amendment rights.
Thank you, Assemblyman.
With regret, I'm going to ask the gentleman committee to hold your questions until afterwards. The Tea Party is asking to allow for their own questioning. I've got a question of my own. It's on demand, so sir, if you'll just indulge me, please, and allow.
Are you cutting off sweating out for the detail?
No, I don't have time. The Tea Party has a question of its own, but the time permitting, we'll try to fit you in as the best I can do. Howard?
Maybe you could explain it. Let me explain something.
No. Please, afterwards you can ask any gentleman who will stay, please. We're respecting the time limit and the schedule we've set. Please.
Here's the point. What's at stake in the state of New York is what's going to happen for the next 50 years. If this Senate goes Democrat, you can kiss your conservative values goodbye. And the Democrats know right now, and this is my question, the ones in Croton, where the opposition is coming from, Croton, Justin Wagner, knows who should win this election, this primary. Justin Wagner knows that Murphy should win. Therefore, his signs now say, why is Murphy backing the pipeline? Why is Murphy backing the pipeline? Because the other guy is a spoiler. The word is he was looking for a job and didn't get it. Please answer those questions.
Howard, please.
Thank you very much. Not only am I a member of Westchester County Tea Party, I'm also a resident of North Salem. And on behalf of Tea Party, we have two questions we'd like to ask. And as you know, our kind of people like to get into the weeds in policy. So I'm going to ask two policy-related questions. First one has to do with budgeting. Last time New York State passed, not this year, but prior to, when they passed the budget, they had to balance the budget by taking money from the workman's comp fund and the mortgage insurance fund. If you look at the laws governing the workman's comp fund, it reads that no money in this fund can be taken from this fund for any other reason. This year it worked so well that this year they had what's called the sweeps. What they're doing to balance the budget is they're going through all these funds, and that has any fund that has in excess of the statutory requirement is being taken out and used for the general fund. And if I'm not mistaken, there's seven parts to the budget, so here's my question. If any part of the budget had a requirement to take money from a fund balance, no matter what part of that budget is, whatever else is in it, would you vote yes or no for that component of the budget?
It's a good question, Howard, and the budgets are very complicated. When we put it on the desk one day, it's about this high if you stack it up. The reality is this. Many of us, and myself included, have voted down parts of the budget, and I, in one case, voted down the whole budget. The fact is, there are parts of it that, unfortunately, are things that none of us like. There are sweeps. The Environmental Protection Fund was raped as a result of what people wanted to sweep out of that. We've had other things taken out of our school funds. So the answer is yes. We vote down part of it. I vote down part of it. I vote down the whole thing if I didn't like it. Problem is you don't have a line item veto, though. So a lot of times what will happen is you'll have a large portion of the budget, maybe $20, $40, $50 billion, wherein you have a multitude of things that are very good for the Office of the Developmentally Disabled and Memory Retardation, for instance, things like that. and you start running into a crisis of conscience. But would I vote one down? Absolutely. I've done it before.
Thank you, Assemblyman. Well, it's the old trick of robbing from Peter to pay Paul and kicking the can, the proverbial can down the road. Why, as a commissioner of a department, should you be penalized for tightening your belt? We had to do it on the town council. We tighten our belt, start thinking outside the box. We rewrote RFPs to allow other competition. Competition's good. Competition drove the price down for our garbage contract. For 1 year, we saved $800,000. In 2 years, we saved $1.6 million. So these guys should think outside the box. Robbing it from another department, all that does is just make that department in 1 year or 2 years or 3 years have them rob from another department. So, no. If the budget director's doing a good job or the commissioner for that department's doing a good job, leave them alone.
Thank you, Doctor. All right.
We have one second question. I want to talk about the new medical marijuana law. As part of the law, there's supposed to be 7 licenses issued. Each license is allowed to have 4 dispensaries. What's happening is that the people and companies and organizations who are putting $1 million in escrow, submitting their forms to be vetted. At the end, and it could be 20 or 30 or 40 organizations looking for these licenses, there are only going to be 7 issued. You know what that means, you can see it coming. So let me ask both of you a question. If one of you are elected, will you immediately sponsor a bill and bring it into committee to go to the floor, which will require a lottery in choosing the appropriate people to get a license?
That's an excellent question. Very good question. But I didn't know, as a healthcare professional, my job is to make sure whatever the opportunity for that person's homeostasis, their person's health, we get. I am completely against the smoking of marijuana out of any of these dispensaries. It is the gateway drug to what is going on, the heroin epidemic that is happening here in northern Westchester and in Putnam County. You don't wake up and become a crack addict or a heroin addict. When you have, as a matter of fact, I'd like to, you know, if we can all take a quick moment of silence, we had 2 deaths last night, 2 heroin overdoses, 1 in Patterson, 1 in Mayo. 22 years old, young kids. This is what's going on. I will fight tooth and nail to fight this heroin epidemic that's going on. The medical marijuana, if it's done the right way, and it's for people that have chemotherapy or radiation that needs to settle their stomach so they can eat, no problem. Smoking it to go up and get its prescription to smoke it, what happens if the person's going into tachycardia?
The concept of a lottery to turn around and sponsor one of the 7 entities is a good one. I think it has merit. I think at the end of the day, though, when you look at these things, you have to look at the vetting process. And frequently, you know, a lottery is a coin toss at the end of the day. When you are vetting people, by the way, this is very much like the casinos that we're now putting in based upon our previous budget, where we're going to have 7 or 9 casinos come in, but you've got, you know, 50 to 100 people applying for them. I don't know that necessarily doing a lottery might be the way to do it. I think it has merit. I think there's a way to do it. And I would say to you that if there's a vetting process where every one of the individual meets a particular standard, then the lottery to do that, I think, would be a good idea. So I would sponsor it then.
Just one last quick question. This is something I know there are issues remaining. Sorry, we'll have to schedule a longer one next time. But unfortunately, we couldn't talk about the Algonquin pipeline, which I've just been apprised of. Thank you, Howard. A gas pipeline, and I hope perhaps some of us can discuss it afterwards. And also the question of immigration, I really think needs closer handling. Time not permitting here. I'd just like to ask about my fair obsession. It's public education. And I was just wondering, Assemblyman, the public education monolith, megalith, is just growing bigger and bigger. Will an assemblyman, will a state senator, Castelli, have any effect on that state of affairs? And do you have any possible solutions or reforms to the world?
You know, if I could answer that question quickly, I could probably pick the right six numbers tonight. having been a college professor for 15 years, I wish there was an easy answer to it. But, you know, being part of public government indicates you have problems with no easy answer. Do we need to do something? Absolutely. We spend more than everybody else. We are down, you know, below where we should be, in the lower half of the 50 states, as far as our deliverables as a result of that. I don't know what the answer is. I do know that as part of the citizenry, we are responsible to serve the public trust. Our tax dollars go to do that. But I think we need to spend smarter and not harder. I think we need to see deliverables, and not, by the way, in the form of Common Core, which, by the way, started out to do that, but obviously failed dismally. So can you do something about it? I think so. Is it easily done? Not necessarily, sir.
Thank you, pretty much Bob hit the nail on the head with that one. Is, you know, if there was a magic bullet to that one, I'm sure they would have already shot it. With regards to, you know, the public education, listen, we need to give everybody the opportunity to succeed. We've just got to make it more affordable so people can live around here. That's all there is to it. How that's done, listen, that's still to be determined. That's all there is to it. It is literally, it's probably 72% of your tax bill with regards to school taxes. You know, it's unfair because you have people that have made up the community for a number of years, and as they get into their golden years, they literally just can't afford to stay here. They have to move, which is unfortunate, because most of the time when you get into your golden, you want to stay within your 6 to 8 mile comfort zone. You don't want to be forced to go down to North Carolina or Florida, and that's what's happening here. Westchester County is the highest tax county, and New York State is the highest tax state. It's a double whammy.
Just final point, would either of you support the expansion of the, or the raising of the charter cap?
Yes. The answer is yes. I actually voted for it in 2010.
Same. Yes.
Same as the Assembly. Same as the document. Confusing. We made provision for a brief closing statement, and I feel constrained to forfeit to you since you opened for
5 minutes.
I think in line with the conditions, maybe 3 minutes.
Okay. First of all, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you for coming here. This is an exercise in democracy. I want to thank Terrence. We have and will debate these issues, in, you know, few and far between. In most cases, we are very similar, as you've seen, in many of our opinions. At the end of the day, as I told you before, I'm not here to tell you why I don't think Terrence should be your senator. I'm here to tell you why I think I should. I've spent a lifetime in the service of my country and my community, as a soldier, as a state trooper, as a college professor, as a small business owner, as a member of a town board, and then finally 2 terms in the New York State Assembly. I have the experience and the know-how to deal with people in Albany. In the New York State Assembly, I succeeded in having an excellent record in spite of the fact that we as Republicans are in the minority. In the majority of the New York State Senate, we can even be more effective. At the end of the day, on September 9th, you have a voice, you have a choice. I would be honored if you choose me. Thank you very much.
That I'd like to read off, but first off, I really appreciate everybody coming out here tonight on a rainy day. It's very nice to be here and see such a lovely crowd. And listen, like Bob said earlier, come hella high water, him and I will continue to be friends. He's a great man, he's a good guy, and Bob, you know where we're at with this. Wish you the best. I'd like to thank the Tea Party for organizing this event. And our moderator, Steve. Steve, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks for giving your time to facilitate what's a fascinating exchange of ideas. Bob, it's always a pleasure to see you, and like I told you before, you always have all my respect.
And you as well, thank you.
When I was contemplating this run for the State Senate, it seemed all the reason to get in or stay out, and it all had to do with my family, whether we were gonna move or whether we were gonna stay. I'm a husband and a father. My wife Caroline has blessed me, like I said, with my 3 beautiful kids. The children were the nucleus of my life. I'm a hands-on dad who spends a lot of time with my little gang. A political campaign is a major commitment and unbelievably time-consuming. But as I studied the issues and looked at the state of affairs in New York, it became clearer and clearer that I needed to do something. I ultimately got into the race because I believe, and everybody, and I've said this once, I've said this twice, everybody deserves the opportunity to succeed. And I believe that is leaving New York State and we need to get it back. The damage has been done to our state over the past 10 years and it's inexcusable. The current slate of so-called leaders in Albany have rendered New York last where it should be first and first where it should be last. If our state continues on its current fiscal trajectory, our kids don't have a chance in hell of enjoying any success and or raising a family here in New York. I'm running for state senate because New York is the least business-friendly state in the nation. We pay the highest taxes in the nation. And quite frankly, our governor, possibly the most corrupt governor in the state's history, and considering our recent past, that's saying a lot. Unfunded mandates are choking our municipalities. The onerous rules and regulations are making it impossible for small businesses like myself to succeed. And we have literally shattered the confidence of our kids with the embarrassment called Common Core. I'm running for state senate because radicals like Bill de Blasio and Justin Wagner are seeking to control the senate and the assembly and the governor's office, and we just must not let that happen. What happens in the 40th senate district will determine the balance of the power of the state senate. And in order to establish a mathematical majority, I need your support in the general election, and I need, in order to get there, I'm asking for your vote and the vote of your friends and your family in next Tuesday's primary. I'm the right candidate for the right job. Thank you, and God bless, and thank you, Bob, for being here tonight.
Well, that concludes tonight's session. Thank you.